talking about the Coping Rehabilitation Class, which is a rehab intervention that we provide here at the Chelsea and Westminster Hospital. So my presentation today is going to be, first of all, what is the Coping Rehabilitation Class? But then I was also going to be talking about kind of how do people get into it, because we know that accessibility to rehabilitation services, even when they are in existence, is still important. Who's referred? Who are the people coming to the programme and why are they referred? But then also looking at attendance and adherence. So how are people attending, how often and actually are they? And then we've got a two-year evaluation of the programme, so we'll give you some of the outcomes that we've done with that. And then also what have we learned? So what are we taking to the future? So the first thing is the COVID Rehabilitation Class is a supervised group exercise programme that takes place twice a week. It's evidence-based in its management, so what we do is we provide cardiovascular exercise, progressive resistance training exercise, we also do some flexibility work, and we do some guided relaxation at the end as well, which is probably the most popular bit of it all, actually. But it's not just exercise. What we also do is we have something called the self-management programme. This has been purposefully named the self-management programme off the back of the Beaver Stands and Care release last year, which was all talking about self-management in Section 9. Now, it takes place with two members of staff, both physical therapists, and one of my physios is with us today. And it takes place twice a week. It takes place on a Tuesday and a Friday. Now, in reality, that's because that's when the gym is free. But the nice thing about it is in the mornings and also it's in the afternoons, so hopefully there's a bit more flexibility about when people can attend. The key thing about the programme is that we're trying to address the physical health challenges that people might be experiencing, but also looking at mental and social well-being. And actually what we're trying to do is we actually want to try and reduce the barriers to addressing these issues. So the programme itself, yes, is focused primarily around exercise, but the key thing is that it's not for anybody that just needs to exercise. Often the people that are coming to the programme, because they've got a reason why it's really challenging to exercise, there's a barrier. So we want to try and address these issues. And actually the self-management programme itself is a key opportunity to signpost to other available services, whether it be within the hospital or outside. So this is a diagram of the self-management programme that we run. So as you can see, it's run by a range of different professionals. But the actual thing itself is that it's a collective group discussion. There are like three fixed themes. So for example, we sit around, we have a chat, for example, today, we'll talk about what services are available in the community outside to continue exercising. And we have the YMCA come in and talk to us. And they come and talk and we discuss, you know, what services are available. We have OTs talking about fatigue management. We have our psychologists talking about goal setting and how to feel self-confident and manage. We have sessions about pain management, but the whole thing is that it's not didactical teaching. It's the collective need of groups that's driving the discussion, so every single session will be slightly different depending on who's there and what the questions are that day. We do a range of outcome measures for this programme as well, and actually the class itself is modelled from an exercise component on the research, but also on the programme that's run at St Thomas's Hospital. And so we use exactly the same outcome measures. We look at height, we look at weight, we look at body shape, we look at people's heart rate, resting heart rate. We do an outcome measure called the 6-minute walk test, so we make people walk up and down a line for 6 minutes, and we say how far they walk over that distance. We do strength testing, we do a health-related quality of life outcome measure, we look at flexibility, and we set goals. So when people come to the programme, what happens is they're actually referred to me and my clinic first. We have a one-to-one session, we discuss, first of all, why have you been referred to physio? Because I think a lot of the time people don't still understand why they need to see a physio when they're having HIV. So actually we have an open discussion about, you know, what are your challenges, what are your needs, is there any way that I can help address these? And if the class is the right thing, we then refer into the class. And we do set goals as part of that about helping people modify behaviours. We do outcome measures at week zero when they start the class, and we aim to do outcome measures at week 10. The key thing about the programme, though, is that it's a completely open access programme. When I first set the programme up, I had a kind of like an outpatient physio head on me where I was like, if people do not attend, they're going to be discharged, they're not going to be able to carry on, thinking about, you know, how are we going to make this service sustainable? I would have an empty service if I did that. We have a completely open access service where now people can come and attend if it's right for them at the right time. If they need to have an interruption to this, for example, with episodic health challenges, okay, come back when you're ready. Door's always open. Come back when you're ready, when the time is right for you. So to access the programme, obviously I mentioned that people need to be referred into the physiotherapy service first and they'll come and see me in clinic. And normally that will be either from an outpatient perspective, but they can be referred by any professional. For example, they could be doctor, physician, nurse, psychologist, or other. They can also come from an inpatient setting. So we have an inpatient HIV ward here, and actually we do provide inpatient rehabilitation as well. So alongside with Esther, we provide inpatient OT and physio. And so sometimes what we'll do is actually as part of their inpatient stay, patients will be able to come down into the program so that they're facilitated in part of a rehab program whilst they're an inpatient, but also as part of their continuity of care, we can actually provide that as they are discharged as well. The other is that obviously there's outpatient physiotherapy services here, and sometimes people will be referred there for musculoskeletal-based reasons, and actually after that, when they're provided with the number of sessions that they're allowed as a service allows them to have, they might have ongoing needs, and so often patients will be referred into my class afterwards for ongoing rehab access. So we've done a 2-year evaluation to look at whether the service actually works in the current model. What we've looked at is who is coming to this program. What were the outcomes of all those range of outcome measures that we've looked at? And also, does it work? And do we need to make any modifications? So over this 2-year period, we've had 92 people referred into the programme, and we've looked at all of the data around those people. So the first thing we looked at is the source of referrals, so who referred into the programme. Now, as you can see, the most common source of referral is actually a physiotherapist, which is probably me, which is a bit self-serving because it means I'm referring people into my program. But also what it means is that it identifies, do people still understand or know about the rehab service that we provide? Do people understand what it's for, what it's about? Why would you refer it to it? But also I think it indicates about the continuity of care, because as a physiotherapist, we will only refer into it if people are even an inpatient. So I think it identifies how many people have ongoing rehab needs once they've left hospital. And as you can see, there's a range of other people that refer to the program, and it shows the openness of the service. You know, we don't have criteria which is you must be a consultant to refer. You know, the dietitians refer for a range of reasons, as do the psychologists. So who is referred to the program? Well, we know that we have 75% men, and this is partly unsurprising because of the cohort we have here in Westminster, predominantly white MSM. And again, that's reflected in our ethnicity of the patients that are referred to the program. Predominantly white as well. But interestingly, we looked at age, and actually the patients that are referred into the programme are generally over the age of 50, and our average age is higher. But also we know that 35% of patients had a dual cancer diagnosis. Now here at the Chelsea and Westminster Hospital, we're actually a national referral centre for HIV-associated malignancies or cancers. So again, that's unsurprising, but I don't know whether that's similar in other settings. So I don't know whether, for example, you have similar things over at Tommy's.
I've never looked at it from a numbers perspective, but that's really interesting. That's moves me to have a look at.
And these are the reasons for referral. So the most common reason is musculoskeletal complaints, you know, aches, pains, problems with mobility. But again, really high oncological complications. Mm-hmm. So whether that be post-chemo fatigue, post-chemo weakness, impaired mobility. But then also cardiometabolic. The dietitians refer to me quite a lot with people that have got weight-related changes, whether there be higher cardiovascular risk in disease, and also problems with just living an active, healthy lifestyle as part of, you know, the holistic management. But again, I think keeping this kind of identified is the reasons why people are referred quite wide. And actually, I think, you know, traditionally, a lot of people think physios deal with aches, pains, back pains, especially in outpatient services. And I think what I'm quite pleased with this is actually the reasons why people are referred are really, really quite wide. Now, I talked about setting goals with people in clinic, and what we did was we actually looked at all of the goals that people are setting, and we tried to pick out the key things. And something that really surprised me was actually the biggest goal, the most frequent goal, was body image concerns. So whether that be, I want to lose weight, I want to put on weight, I want my body to look different, I'm unhappy with my body. And actually, that's a really common thing that comes out. And so actually, as part of the self-management program, we're now introducing a body image workshop. So that actually for half an hour we have talk about what are the issues relating to body image. You know, how can you feel confident about the way that you feel and how can you move forward with that? But other things, for example, participation. So whether that being able to participate in day-to-day roles, whether it be going out and being able to attend the church where you get your social supports. And participate in employment as well. But then other things like mobility and health and fitness, into the more kind of classic model of what rehab or physio, for example, will be doing. But the goals are huge. So, for example, some people talk about wanting to be more happy, or socially engaged, being more functional, reducing pain, improving sleep. Now, when we look at kind of adherence and attendance, we know that the research suggests that for a 10-week program of twice-weekly exercise for people living with HIV, you are classified as adherent if you attend 8 or more sessions out of those 20 available sessions. Our program had an adherence rate of 46%, which actually in comparison to that is worse than the results that came out of the Tommy study with this, which I think was 54% adherence. Now, interestingly, what we also looked at was the median attendance. So, you know, what was the average amount of time people were taking? And that was only 6 out of the possible 20 sessions. But what we did, because I've got an open access program, we were also able to look at who came back. And we showed that 37% of patients actually returned to restart the program. So these are people that are classified as non-adherent, as not wanting to be in the program. But actually, there was something going on. Why did they come back to the program? Why did they restart? What happened? Is this, you know, numbers demonstrating episodic disability in relation to the rehabilitation? So when it comes to the outcome measures, and the centre got the range of outcome measures that we were looking at, we only managed to complete outcome measures at week 10 or 21% of people. Now, actually, there are kind of two key areas why this is a challenge. I think the first, as I've shown with adherence and attendance, if people aren't there, we can't take measures on people. So actually, adherence is a problem in relation to data collection. But the other issue as well is we collect so many outcome measures, and we have to have half an hour to do these outcome measures. And so because the gym is confined in its time and flexibility, we have one session a week, half an hour, to do these outcome measures on a Tuesday before the class starts. So if people don't attend that session to do the outcome measures, logistically, we are inflexible with our ability to measure these outcome measures, so they don't get done. So I looked at how many people had the outcome measures done, and 41% of them do have them completed. And interestingly, we looked at how many weeks after week 10 they had their outcome measures completed. And as you can see, one week later was, you know, up there as one of the most common time frames, along with a month later. So, you know, there's no kind of pattern here as to how frequently people might be having their outcome measures actually completed. But I think the 1 week might actually be a logistical thing. And I think the 1 month is probably looking at more kind of the challenges associated with adherence. So, outcome measures. Heart rate, weight, and body shape. I haven't said thank you to Richard yet, because Richard is responsible for all of these numbers, thank you. there was no significant difference in the results of, you know, body shape. So this is what, like, measurements around nipple, belly button, white part is. Weight and also heart rate. But the thing about this is it's kind of unsurprising. We've got a really heterogeneous group. We've got people who want to lose weight, people want to gain weight. So for example, we looked at body mass index of people that are attending the program, and as you can see, it's really quite wide. People were referred underweight, normal, overweight, and obese. And so actually, we're trying to look at kind of like the binary of this, you know, have people improved? Well, actually, we haven't actually split the data into kind of those that are underweight, overweight, and whether they're going in the perceived right direction. So it's unsurprising we didn't have any significant changes in those numbers. But interestingly, looking at these outcome measures, so the 6-minute walk test, getting people to walk up and down, measuring the heart rate before and after, and the length of distance that they are able to walk. Looking at strength, how many times can I do lifting up a bicep curl, for example, and at different measurements across upper limb and lower limb. FAHI, so health-related quality of life questionnaire about living with HIV, and then flexibility, sitting on a box, which is quite important. What we showed, 6-minute walk test, significant improvements in the scores. So on average, the results showed that people were walking 86 metres further when they had their outcome measures completed. Now, interestingly, so it's a sub-maximal test of exertion. Patients living with COPD, the significant point of that is actually achieving more than 54 metres of walking. So our cohort are achieving way above that, which is great. So what we did was also, we looked at the difference between those people that completed the 6 minutes of walking and those people that couldn't complete the whole 6 minutes of this test. And both those groups actually still had bigger improvements than people living with COPD. So even if patients can't achieve the full 6 minutes of this test, they still have improvements above 64 meters. Strength, significant improvement in all of the strength measurements. Biceps, triceps, shoulders, chest, legs. All of these things improved. Health-related quality of life. Now actually, the FAHI is split into different domains. And so you've got physical well-being, you've got emotional well-being, you've got functional global well-being, you've got social well-being and cognitive functioning. And the data showed that there were significant improvements in physical well-being, well, I think that's good, we'd like to see that, and actually if you're exercising, that'll change. But interestingly, there were significant results in emotional well-being as well. There was a trend towards improvements in global and functional well-being, but there was no change in social or cognitive function. These are self-reported scales. And the last one, flexibility. On average, it's statistically significant, people would improve by up to 4 centimeters, reaching a lot further. So, that's great, exercise works. And something that I didn't mention is that all of the research around exercise in HIV talks about exercising at a particular time. So, for example, following the American College of Sports Medicine's guidelines on exercising at 60% heart rate of 70% of your maximum strength. Well, we can't do that because actually you'll be standing there with a whip kind of flogging away saying you must exercise harder to get 60%. We don't do that at all. It's actually more like an introduction to exercise. It's kind of, okay, this is the bike, this is how you get on it, this is how you cycle. And so what is really brilliant about the results is that even though we're not exercising as the guidelines tell us we should be exercising, we're still getting significant improvements in people's outcomes. So one of the other things that was looked at was whether there was any predictors. So, for example, all of the outcome measures, did they predict whether someone would be classified as adherent or not? So whether they attended 8 or more sessions. So, we had a look at that. Instead of it being binary where you are adherent, you are not adherent, looked at whether there was a trend of the number of sessions that were people were attending. And what was really interesting is that actually those people that could walk further at week 0 doing the 6-minute walk test were more likely to attend more sessions. Now I think that's a really interesting finding, because does that mean that people that are less disabled are more likely to be adherent? Or does that mean that people have got the ability to attend? I don't know, I'm kind of plucking out of air there, but I think that's a really interesting finding that needs to be explored a little bit more. There's something here around people's physical ability leading to adherence. So what did we learn from all of this stuff? Well, we learned that we've got a really heterogeneous group. You know, we've got different weights, we've got different ages, they've got different goals. And also the reason for referral. Why were people referring to the program? Very good. Reduced adherence, that's what we also learned from this. We know that it's poor adherence. But the key thing for me is, what does this actually mean in this context, considering people are coming back? Is this just, you know, another example of the episodic nature of this? You can't be able to adhere as well. Accessibility. I think that it's really interesting to see how many people came back to the program. Over a third of patients returned to restart the program. What does that mean? Why are people coming back? What is the meaning behind that? What's the value in this program? And people being able to come back and have that open accessibility. The intervention works, which is good. We know that exercise works in this setting. But predictors. I think that's a really interesting thing, because if we're going to be able to provide an intervention, it would be quite nice to know that the intervention, considering a heterogeneous group, might not be what everybody needs. So actually, do we need to be thinking about what other models of rehabilitation, what other interventions, what's right for who? And actually, if we're predictors of that, that might help. So for example, we know that you can walk further, so therefore you're probably going to be able to do better in this program. But if you can't walk further, what options do we have for you until you get to be able to walk further? And outcome measures. I think we record too many outcome measures in my program, actually. I think it leads to complete lack of flexibility. It means that we are unable to assess people when they attend, when the time's right for them. And actually, that means that we're unable to actually provide people with feedback as much. And that may also have a knock-on effect of adherence, actually. Because if you're not getting feedback of how well you're doing and whether you're improving, why would you continue to come? So, research and modifications. What we're going to do for the future is, how are we moving this forward? Well, for me, it's got to be the outcome measures. We need to look at what we're doing with this. And I think one of the key things is, obviously, we're using the FAR here to help with the quality of life outcome measure. But I would really like to be using the HIV disability questionnaire to look at the level of disability that people are experiencing on a wider frame, you know, using the episodic disability framework. And I think that it will be interesting to see whether there's an element of predictor in that. You know, is the level of disability that people are experiencing a predictor for whether they can or can't attend? Adherence and attendance. I think it would be really interesting to kind of find out what does that definition of attending more than 8 sessions out of 20 mean in this context? Is it valuable? Is it meaningful? Does it lead to, what can we learn from that? The predictors, as I mentioned, I think are a really key thing. But also something I've not mentioned once is evaluation of the self. That's the unique selling point of this program, because there are other exercise interventions, but what we have with the self-management program has been quite unique. And actually, we can't evaluate that, the outcome measures. So actually, I think that part of the future needs to be looking at two different components. We need to be looking at the qualitative stuff, but also the qualitative stuff. So we actually need to be sitting there and doing face-to-face interviews, although I don't know if I can do it in YouTube. Why are people attending the program? What are they getting out of the program? What are they not getting by not attending the program? So I just